You carry on. People can hear.
Okay.
Because they can't talk.
Fine. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I think there's a slight change in the topic. Instead of renal tubular disorders, I'll be talking on potassium homeostasis and disorders in the newborn. A little more focused on potassium, being renal tubular disorders being a vast topic. As we all know that life started in the sea, there are a lot of theories about how life started, but all of them says that life did start in the sea. There is evidence for this based on the fact that we have found a lot of fossil cells and bacteria in the sea. Sea has a steady concentration of salts, and that is a basic requirement for life. Function of living cells is critically dependent on a constant electrolyte composition. Now, for life to evolve on land, it was made possible because of the development of kidneys. Kidneys provide the constant internal milieu required for the adequate functioning of the living cell. Hence, this hyperkalemias would impair cell function and lead to morbidity as well as mortality. Just some brief about glomerular function in perineal period. We know that in fetus, placenta functions as an excretory organ and receives about 35% of fetal cardiac output, as compared to fetal kidneys that receive only about 3%. This is in contrast to the postnatal renal perfusion of about 25% cardiac output. The fetal GFR increases with gestational age, mainly related to increase in the renal mass. Now, we know that newborn babies, be it term babies or preterm babies, have physiological renal failure. Their GFR is 10 to 20 mLs per minute per 1.73 meter square. It doubles by around 2 weeks of age, triples at around 2 to 3 months of age, and reaches the adult value of 100 to 120 mLs per minute by 2 years of age. There are a number of factors which contribute to the postnatal increase in glomerular filtration rate, most important being the increase in the surface area due to the expansion of the mesangium. Second, increase in their capillary permeability. Third, increase in renal blood flow, as we saw that the renal blood flow increases from 3% in the fetal life to 25% postnatally, and also because of increase in glomerular capillary pressure related to the reduction in the peripheral vascular resistance. So a number of factors result in an increase in the glomerular filtration rate over the first 2 years of postnatal life. Coming to potassium homeostasis, we all know that potassium is the major intracellular cation, and 98% of the total body stores is present in the ICF as against 2% in the ECF. Now, ICF concentration is about 100 to 140 milliequivalents per liter, as against about 4 to 5 milliequivalents per liter in the extracellular fluid. This is in contrast to sodium, which is primarily restricted to extracellular fluid and is responsible for maintenance of the blood pressure. The location of sodium in the ECF and potassium in the ICF, that is in the different fluid compartments, is maintained by the ubiquitous sodium-potassium ATPase pump in the cell membrane, which basically functions to pump sodium out and potassium into the cell in a 3:2 ratio. In children, the physiological range for plasma potassium concentration, as we are aware, is 3.5 to 5.2 or maybe 5.5 milliequivalents per liter. In term neonates, up to 6 milliequivalents per liter is considered acceptable, whereas in preterm babies, even up to 6.5 milliequivalents per liter is considered physiological. So neonates and infants are known to maintain positive potassium balance like phosphorus balance. Potassium, phosphorus, and magnesium are the predominant intracellular cations. This is necessary to allow incorporation of potassium into the newly formed cells. The physiological reason for higher plasma potassium concentration is basically reduced renal excretion. And why is the kidney not able to excrete potassium unlike in older children? For two main reasons. decrease in the potassium transporters on the luminal membrane, as well as because of reduced intracellular signaling pathways associated with aldosterone function. So because of both these factors, there is reduced renal excretion and plasma potassium levels of up to 6.5 in a preterm and 6.0 in a term neonate is acceptable and physiological. Potassium, as we all know, has two major physiological functions. One, it is involved in cell metabolism, regulation of protein, as well as glycogen synthesis, and most important, neural and muscle function. It is the ratio of intracellular to extracellular potassium concentration which determines the RMP, and that we know sets the stage for the generation of action potential. Thus, both hypo as well as hyperkalemia can result in potentially life-threatening cardiac arrhythmias as well as muscle paralysis. Regulation of plasma potassium concentration is dependent on two major factors physiologically. Potassium is added into the extracellular fluid through potassium intake orally or intravenously, and also because of potassium which is released from cell metabolism. So what happens to this potassium which suddenly comes into the extracellular fluid? We know the ECF has to have a very narrow range of potassium concentration, 3.5 to 5.5. The first that leads hyperkalemia is shifting of potassium from ECF to ICF. And this is done by two baseline hormones, catecholamines, mainly epinephrine and insulin. And this is done with the help of the ubiquitous sodium potassium ATPase, which pumps three sodiums out and two potassiums in. Once the intracellular shift has taken place, ultimately the body has to get rid of the potassium, and that happens predominantly by the kidneys. 90% of the dietary and cellular metabolism related potassium is excreted by the kidneys. Less than 10% is excreted in the feces. This is a schematic diagram. Coming to the potassium homeostasis by the kidneys, nephron, the proximal convoluted tubules, the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle, the distal convoluted tubule, and the collecting tubules over here. As we can see that almost 100% of potassium is reabsorbed by the time it reaches DCT, about 80% in the proximal convoluted tubule, 20% in the DCT. Then how do we lose potassium in the urine? As we know, there are three ways we can excrete any salt in the urine, either by filtration, by limited reabsorption, or by secretion. With potassium, it is very clear that potassium is freely and completely filtered, being a small molecule. It is completely reabsorbed by the time it reaches DCT, and the potassium excretion in the urine is dependent upon secretion. And this is very important to know, because we will come to some factors which are associated with potassium secretion. Potassium reabsorption in the proximal tubule, as well as in the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle, is predominantly passive and along the paracellular pathway. So how do we secrete potassium? The way we excrete potassium is by secreting potassium from the cell into the luminal membrane. And the principal cell of the cortical collecting duct is the site where potassium secretion takes place the most. We can see there are two major players over here. On the right side, it is aldosterone, and on the left side is distal sodium delivery. We'll come to these two factors in some detail subsequently. It's important to understand this because it will help us in analyzing the problems associated with potassium disorders. This is just an expanded cartoon of principal cell of DCT, of the cortical collecting duct, and the cells of the distal convoluted tubule. Our focus is going to be on the right-sided cell over here, the principal cell. The upper level is the basolateral or the blood level side, and the bottom level is the luminal membrane, luminal side of the cell over here. as we have seen that there are three major factors which determine potassium secretion: aldosterone, distal sodium delivery, and distal water flow or distal tubular flow rate. Aldosterone is a predominant hormone responsible for potassium secretion. Aldosterone acts by stimulating the sodium potassium ATPase pump, which brings sodium out, potassium in, increasing the potassium concentration inside, decreasing the sodium concentration inside. Second, it acts upon the mineralocorticoid receptor in the cytosol, which subsequently increases the deposition of epithelial sodium channel on the luminal membrane of the principal cell, and it also stimulates the renal outer medullary potassium channels through which potassium generally is secreted in the lumen. So aldosterone has three effects: stimulates the sodium potassium ATPase, increases the placement of epithelial sodium channel, and opens up the renal outer medullary potassium channels. When there is increased distal delivery of sodium, which happens, for example, with proximal RTA, the higher sodium concentration over here in presence of aldosterone, because there is a gradient, higher sodium in the lumen, lower in the cellular, in the cytosol, sodium gets reabsorbed. Negative charges are left behind. To neutralize that, potassium is secreted. So increased distal delivery of sodium will increase sodium reabsorption and increase potassium secretion. Similarly, if there is increased flow, even in absence of sodium, the increased flow will wash out the potassium which is secreted, lowering the luminal potassium level and allowing a higher concentration gradient for potassium to be secreted. So three major factors which promote potassium secretion are aldosterone, increased distal delivery of sodium, and increased distal tubular luminal flow. So in summary, at a basal level, the distribution of potassium between cells and the ECF is primarily governed by the sodium potassium ATPase pump in the cell membrane. After a dietary load, most of the potassium is taken up by the cells, a process which is facilitated by basal levels of catecholamines and insulin, and this process minimizes the increase in plasma potassium concentration. And finally, the potassium which has been ingested has to be excreted or secreted by the potassium load over the next 12 to 24 hours, mainly with the effect of aldosterone. To summarize, urinary potassium wasting and hypokalemia are due to an activation of the distal secretory potassium mechanism. So when we are talking about hypokalemia, it is not because of increased filtration, it is not because of decreased reabsorption, it is because of increased secretion. And as we know, the three factors which are responsible for secretion has to be disturbed to cause either hypokalemia or hyperkalemia. Hyperaldosteronism, as long as distal flow is maintained, for example, proximal RTA, distal RTA, increased distal flow, as long as aldosterone secretion is normal or it is increased as a diuretics, can cause hypokalemia. And delivery of sodium to distal nephron with a non-reabsorbable anion, as with DKA, for example, ketoacids. Type 2 RTA, the bicarbonate which is not completely reabsorbed in the proximal tubule, goes along with sodium to the distal nephron, where sodium is reabsorbed and potassium and bicarbonate are lost in the urine. Penicillins are also an example of non-reabsorbable anion, which can contribute to hypokalemia. So activation of distal secretory process can lead to hypokalemia. Conversely, hyperkalemia will be associated with a defect in distal potassium secretion. This happens either when there is no aldosterone or aldosterone is there, but there is a defect in its activity, which happens with true hypoaldosteronism or pseudohypoaldosteronism. And the second situation is when there is decreased distal flow rate. So even though there may be hyperaldosteronism, but there is no delivery of sodium in the distal nephron, potassium secretion is going to be affected. So two major factors are hypoaldosteronism and decreased distal flow rate, which can contribute to hyperkalemia. So let's just move on from physiology to some cases over here. We have a 1 month boy who presented with failure to thrive, vomiting off and on since 10 days of life. Birth history, he is born at 33 weeks of gestation due to premature rupture of membranes and had a birth weight of 2 kilos. On examination, he is 2.3 kilos at 1 month. Blood pressure is just acceptable or on the lower side. He is malnourished and there are some signs of dehydration. So, is this history adequate? I think as we have heard the other day, taking a detailed history is very, very important. If we don't concentrate on history, we are not going to be able to come to a sound differential diagnosis. Is this child having failure to thrive because of decreased intake, because of decreased milk production? Is it because the child is vomiting? Is the child hungry? Is the child having some oral problems? So these are the points which we need to dwell into. The child did have history of constipation and is always hungry. So it's not that the child does not want to drink. Child is hungry, wants to drink, but is still not able to thrive well. Birth history. I think we often ignore the important points and pointers which we get from the birth history. This child is born preterm, had a PROM. Did we try to find out why did the child have PROM? Because of polyhydramnios. The amniotic fluid index was 28 centimeters and the birth weight is 2.0. On examination, besides the general examination, our focus should be on skin hyperpigmentation, which will give us a clue towards congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Genitalia, especially in a baby girl, which could be ambiguous. In a boy with CAH, usually the genitalia are normal at birth. They develop precocious puberty at 8 to 10 years of age. So normal male genitalia does not rule out CAH in a baby boy. Are there any renal or bladder masses? Are we dealing with a boy with obstructive uropathy? So these are the points which we need to focus on. Moving on to some basic investigations on this child. The child had a urine specific gravity of 10.05. No protein, no sugar, there were no cells. And the blood gas was suggestive of metabolic alkalosis or alkalemia, 7.49, 48 and bicarb of 33. There was severe hyponatremia, hypokalemia, hypochloremia and confirmation of high bicarbonate. Renal function test was suggestive of prerenal AKI. Rest of the parameters were normal except magnesium on the lower side. Kidney sizes were normal and there was no nephrocalcinosis. So to summarize, we have a 1 month boy with failure to thrive, constipation and vomiting. There is hypokalemic, hypochloremic, metabolic alkalosis and there is prerenal AKI. So what are we dealing with? I think there are very few differentials over here. Are we dealing with an upper GI losses of hydrochloric acid? Is it pyloric stenosis? Could it be GER or could it be malrotation? Can there be lower GI causes? Though lower GI causes usually cause metabolic acidemia because of loss of bicarbonate in the large intestinal juices. Very, very rarely we may come across congenital chloridiarrhea, which may cause metabolic alkalosis, but that's extremely rare. Or are we dealing with renal losses? Is the child on diuretics? There was nothing to suggest the child was on diuretics. The child does not have bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Or does the child have inherited renal tubulopathy? So there are three major places where sodium chloride and potassium can be lost. Upper GI, lower GI and renal. So can any additional investigations help us? Yes. And I think besides history, which would give us a clue in 90% of cases, some selected investigations would help us confirm or eliminate one of our differentials. So spot urine electrolytes is a very simple way of assessing the urinary electrolyte losses and tell us whether it's a renal or the non-renal source of electrolyte losses. Here the sodium was 156, potassium is 34 and chloride is 44. All of them are more than 20 milliequivalents per liter and they are high. Fractional excretion of potassium was 20%, reference range being 8 to 10%. If required, if there's a doubt, are we dealing with an upper GI pathology, which is very common, we need to obtain a gastrographic study. There are some centers who would recommend obtaining plasma renin activity and plasma aldosterone levels. Usually in my own experience, it is not necessary, because as you would observe that any patient with dehydration will have elevated plasma renin activity and aldosterone levels. By default, they will be elevated because that's the body's defense to reabsorb sodium chloride at the proximal as well as the distal nephron by aldosterone and by angiotensin II. So it's not necessary to obtain PRN aldosterone. Elevated plasma renin activity and aldosterone levels are not going to give us any specific information except that, yes, the child is dehydrated. Urinary excretion of chloride more than 20 milligrams per liter is suggestive of renal chloride wasting. And that's an important message which I would like to share. Fractional excretion of potassium more than 10% is again suggestive of renal potassium wasting. And hence, we are focusing here on a renal cause of dyselectrolytemia. The closest differential for this is going to be an upper GI pathology to Bartter syndrome. So how do we differentiate between the two? I think both of these conditions are going to have failure to thrive, vomiting, polydipsia, polyuria because of hypokalemia, constipation because of volume depletion and hypokalemia, and the typical hypokalemic, hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis. Hence, going back to the basics of history, which Dr. Amdekar stressed upon repeatedly day before yesterday, I think go back to the antenatal history. There is history suggestive of polyhydramnios, and as we know, there are very few causes of polyhydramnios. One of them is renal tubulopathy, mainly Bartter syndrome, where there is fetal polyuria, or it could be because of upper GI obstruction, but that's rare. Here, antenatal scans are usually going to be normal. Preterm delivery, mainly because of preterm rupture of membrane. Usually it's a term delivery with AGA baby. Urinary chloride excretion is going to be high because the kidney is the source of sodium chloride wasting, whereas here the kidneys are going to reabsorb chloride to maintain intravascular volume, to maintain intravascular volume. Hypomagnesemia is seen in about 50% of babies with Bartter syndrome. But a normal magnesium hence will not only, once we start treating these children, I'm sure most of us would have realized that a child with antenatal Bartter or Bartter syndrome type 1 and type 2, they are very, very difficult to treat as compared to children with upper GI pathology. We keep them healed by mouth, give them appropriate IV fluids, and their electrolytes will normalize in 2 to 5 days of therapy. So the closest differential here is going to be an upper GI pathology, and there are some simple pointers to help us differentiate between the two. The child was started on salt replacement, both IV followed by oral, potassium replacement, and after improvement in the AKI, ibuprofen syrup was started along with magnesium replacement. Let's move on to another patient. This is a child which we saw last week. It's a 2 months baby girl who presented with irritability for 2 weeks, had mild fever, cough and nausea for 2 to 3 days duration. She was born at term with birth weight of 3 kilos, AFI of 20 centimeters. On examination, she was weighing 4.3 kilos. There was dehydration, mild respiratory distress, no abdominal mass, no hyperpigmentation. Urine had specific gravity of 10-15, pH of 6.5, no protein, no sugar, and occasional WBCs. Further investigations again showed similar picture like the first child, hyponatremia, hypochloremia, hypokalemia, and elevated bicarbonate. Again, there was significant metabolic alkalosis with prenatal AKI. So we have a child similar to the first one who has gotten hypokalemic, hypochloremic, metabolic alkalosis. Any further questions which would help us come to a differential diagnosis? Yes, did this child have polyuria or what was the urinary volume? And this is a simple question which most uneducated mothers will also be able to mention to us. This child did not have polyuria. In fact, the mother mentioned that the urine volumes have decreased significantly. Child is thirsty and is demanding feeds. There was some vomiting for the past 2 days, but before 2 days, the child was absolutely fine without any upper GI symptoms. And amniotic fluid index was on the upper limit of normal, 20 centimeters. There is no family history of renal problems. And how about urinary electrolytes? So this child had reduced urinary output. Child was hungry. Occasional vomiting for 2 days. A5 can be considered to be normal. And there was no significant family history. So to further differentiate, we obtained urine electrolytes. Sodium is 36, potassium is 44, and chloride is 15. Child was appropriately treated at the primary hospital with sodium, with normal saline bolus, followed by half normal saline with 5 to 10 milliequivalents of KCl per 500 ml over 2 days. And the mild respiratory infection settled down spontaneously. 2 days later, the electrolytes were 144, 4.5, 102, and 26, almost close to being normal. And the blood gas had normalized 7.42, PCO2 of 36, and bicarb of 24. So, interpretation: high urinary potassium losses over year, 44. Is suggestive of a renal potassium loss, but low urinary chloride concentration suggests renal chloride, suggests non-renal chloride losses. I apologize for the mistake over here. It's a non-renal chloride losses. In the first case, the urinary chloride concentration was very high. Here, the urinary chloride concentration is only 15 milliequivalents per liter. So chloride concentration less than 20 would mean that the kidneys are trying to conserve chloride. And it is some other reason why the child is having hypokalemic metabolic alkalosis. So what's the probable diagnosis in this child? The biochemical parameters are almost similar to the first child, except the history is quite different. This child was asymptomatic until 2 weeks ago. Please look at the weight gain from 3 kilos, he's 4.3 kilos in say 50 days after the first 10 days. That's a good amount of weight gain, and he has presented at the beginning of summer months. So could we be dealing with cystic fibrosis? And the possibility is quite high. This is a non-renal salt wasting. Urinary chloride concentration is low. Urinary potassium losses are high. Why is urinary potassium concentration high? Because of metabolic alkalosis, the filtered bicarbonate, which is above the level or threshold of reabsorption, more than 22, the bicarb starts coming out in the urine. The bicarbonate, being an anion, a negatively charged molecule, has to come out with a positive ion. And the two predominant positive ions in the urine are sodium and potassium. Body needs sodium to maintain the intravascular volume. So at the cost of sodium, potassium is being lost along with bicarbonate, and hence we end up having hypokalemia. Another important observation, if you can notice, is this patient's electrolytes normalized within 48 hours. And let me tell you, friends, that renal tubulopathy, it's very, very difficult to manage as Bartter syndrome. What to give them? It's like a bucket with a hole at the bottom. They keep on losing electrolytes. So we will never be able to normalize electrolytes in a child with Bartter syndrome. So a fact that this child's electrolytes normalize in 48 hours and the other factors strongly suggest that we are dealing with cystic fibrosis. And this, my friends, is an under-detected problem in our country. It's not just common in Western country, but I think different phenotypes are seen in our country as well. Certainly, we suggested them to monitor the child for now, nurse the child in a cool environment, and obtain genetic tests for mutations involved in the CFTR protein. In older children, we could consider sweat chloride test. In this child, because of inadequate sweat volume, it won't be visible. So friends, hypokalemic differential diagnosis Very few. First and foremost, we need to make sure there is no reduced intake, which is seen more in older children with malnutrition. Make sure there are no sweat losses. We should be ruling out cystic fibrosis. And then there are three possibilities. This is because of intracellular redistribution, which happens with alkalemia, because of insulin or hyperglycemia, or because of use of beta 2 stimulation drugs. Renal losses, most common is diuretics, Bartter syndrome or renal tubular acidosis, hypomagnesemia, non-VA absorbable anions, as we said, with some molecules like in DKA, older children, not in a newborn, and penicillin antimicrobials. GI losses would be, most common would be vomiting, nasogastric aspiration, and diarrhea. Friends, the most common cause of hypokalemic metabolic alkalosis is vomiting, vomiting, and vomiting. So please try to think about vomiting as the most common cause. Following that, diarrhea. Is the child treated with diuretics? And then think about renal tubulopathy or cystic fibrosis in that order. So please don't jump to conditions such as renal tubulopathy first, where we end up missing common diagnosis, which are always going to be noticed frequently. Etiology is apparent after a careful history. Detailed physical examination. I don't think we can emphasize the importance of taking a detailed history. I think if we can spend 10 to 15 to 20 minutes with every patient the first time they come to us, let the parent talk, note down the salient points, ask leading questions, examine the child, ask for specific investigations, and then narrow down your differential diagnosis. Always make a point to know what medications is the neonate as well as the mother on. Basic investigations, we do not need a sophisticated set of investigations. Blood gas, blood urea, serum creatinine, urine electrolytes, and an ultrasound abdomen. They are basic investigations which can help us come to a diagnosis. Urine potassium excretion, we already discussed. A spot urine potassium less than 20 would mean non-renal losses. Fractional excretion of potassium less than 10% would mean non-renal potassium losses. Easy to calculate. The way we calculate FeNA, the same way we can calculate fractional excretion of potassium. And this is the last case. It's a 3 weeks baby boy who presented with vomiting and failure to thrive. Born at term with birth weight of 3 kilos. Amniotic fluid was not available, the details. Weight is 2.5 kilos. He's below the birth weight. He's dehydrated, no congenital anomalies, and no clinical signs of sepsis. He's got trace protein with a specific gravity of 10-10, but no sugar. His electrolyte showed sodium of 128, potassium of 6.8, chloride of 85. Here the bicarbonate is 17. There was mild metabolic acidemia, 7.26, with a bicarb of 16. Hemogram showed mild hemoconcentration. Urea creatinine were normal. And the urine potassium was 10 milliequivalents per liter and fractional excretion of potassium was 4%, meaning both of them was suggesting that the kidneys were not losing potassium. Or why were the kidneys not losing potassium? In the presence of high potassium, the kidney should be losing more amount of potassium. So to summarize, it's a 3 weeks baby boy with failure to thrive, birth weight of 3 kilos and now 2.5 kilos, has got vomiting, hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, mild metabolic acidemia, and there is decreased renal excretion. What is the etiology? I think when we are dealing with a child with hyperkalemia, it's much more easier as compared to when we are dealing with hypokalemia. First and foremost, we need to make sure we are not dealing with either chronic kidney disease or an acute kidney injury. Are we dealing with aldosterone deficiency, as in congenital adrenal hyperplasia, or are we dealing with aldosterone resistance, that is pseudo-hypoaldosteronism? And based on this, we need to work up the child. So there are three possibilities. CKD or AKI, ultrasound will give you a lot of information over here. Hypodysplastic kidney, the kidneys will be small. normal to increased size in kidneys with echogenicity of the cortex would suggest proximal tubular dysgenesis. Hydroureteronephrosis on ultrasound and confirmation in NCOG would tell us whether we are dealing with posterior urethral walls or primary VUR. Aldosterone deficiency could be either with CAH or a complete adrenal insufficiency as with Addison's disease, skin color, ambiguous genitalia, increased 17-OHP, cortisol and testosterone would help us differentiate aldosterone deficiency from aldosterone resistance. In this situation, aldosterone is present but not able to act either at the receptor or at the ENaC level, and hence the level is very high but the aldosterone effect is not there. Hence, it's a pseudo deficiency, pseudo hypoaldosteronism, where the aldosterone level is going to be very, very high. In this child, there was prenatal AKI, ultrasound was normal, MCG was not done, but when there's a doubt, we should always do it to make sure we are not dealing with PUV or primary high-grade VUR, which can present in similar manner. Clinically, there was nothing to suggest CAH, cortisol came back normal, 17-OHP also was normal, and the plasma aldosterone level came back very high at 1200 nanograms per ml. So we were dealing with a child with pseudo-hypoaldosteronism, turned out to be type 1A, which was a renal limited. And this is just a schematic diagram showing the same principal cell of cortical collecting duct over here. In type 1A pseudo-hypoaldosteronism, there's a defect in the mineralocorticoid receptor, whereas in type 1B, there's a defect in the epithelial sodium channel, which is present not only on the luminal membrane of the cell, but also it is present in skin, in GI tract, as well as in pulmonary lining. So type 1B, pseudo-hypoaldosteronism type 1B is a generalized form of pseudo-hypoaldosteronism, whereas type 1A, which is because of defect in the mineralocorticoid receptor, it is a renal limited and this has a better prognosis. Treatment is giving salt. This is one of the very few conditions where we need to provide the child with extra salt and potassium restriction in weaning foods as well as potassium binders till the child usually outgrows this problem by 1.5 to 2 years of age. So last few slides, in hyperkalemia, we worry about when the potassium is more than 6.5 milliequivalents per liter. In premature babies, high potassium is noted in up to 50%. We are certainly worried about cardiac arrhythmias, muscle weakness, and sudden death. And how do we approach a patient with hyperkalemia in a newborn situation? First and foremost, we need to make sure that this is true hyperkalemia and not fictitious hyperkalemia. Is there hemolysis when the sample was collected? Was it too much of squeezing? Was the sample transferred through the needle and not after opening the hub of the container and removing the needle? Does the child have thrombocytosis, leukocytosis, where there is breakdown of the cells in vitro, which can release potassium? Or sometimes the sample may have been drawn from the line, which is contaminated with the IV fluids, which is containing potassium. So this is something very simple, but we need to make sure that these issues are not there before we evaluate further. Once we know that it is true hyperkalemia, there are three situations we need to look at. Is it an increased intake of potassium in the form of IV, either accidental or accidental most often? Is the child getting oral potassium? Is the child getting human milk fortifier? And this is something which we realize that HMF has a good amount of potassium in it. So in preterm babies, we need to be a little careful because HMF addition can contribute to hyperkalemia when there are other factors contributing to it as well. Is the child receiving blood transfusion? So increased intake, IV or oral, HMF and blood transfusion. Is there a transcellular shift? Is there metabolic acidemia? Is the child having beta adrenergic blocking agents? Did the child have seizures? Or is a child having sepsis and DIC with release of potassium from RBCs? Once the second group has been eliminated, we are left with only three conditions which can cause hyperkalemia: renal failure, aldosterone deficiency or aldosterone resistance. Fortunately, drugs are not a major cause of hyperkalemia in newborns, but in older children, we need to be aware that drugs can also contribute to hyperkalemia. So again, hyperkalemia, there are only three main reasons. Is it kidney failure? Is it aldosterone deficiency? Is it aldosterone resistance? Or is it because of drugs like ACE inhibitors, heparin, NSAIDs and Aldecton? Not so much in newborn, but in older children is something which we need to be aware about. So to approach a child with hyperkalemia, we need serum, or to be more accurate, plasma electrolytes, a venous blood gas, complete blood count with sepsis screen if required, complete urine examination. This will tell us whether there's any acid-base disturbance, is there any DIC or sepsis. Get an ECG to confirm whether we are dealing with true hyperkalemia in terms of ECG changes of hyperkalemia. Make sure that the renal parameters are normal. Obtain fractional excision of potassium. PTKG is useful in older children, but not so much in neonates because they have an impaired concentrating ability, and that's one of the parameters which is required to calculate TTKG. So TTKG is not that much helpful in newborns as compared to in older children with hyperkalemia. Ultrasound abdomen, certainly, to make sure we are not dealing with an obstructive uropathy. And if required, if we are dealing with true or pseudo hypoaldosteronism, we need to obtain plasma cortisol, 17 hydroxyprogesterone, plasma aldosterone, and 17 and testosterone assays. Again, like with hypokalemia, the etiology is apparent with a carefully obtained detailed history, physical examination, review of medication, including those taken by the mother, what milk products the child is taking, and basic chemistry panel, including blood gas, blood urea, and serum creatinine. The management of hyperkalemia, I will not go into the detail. I think we are all familiar with this. To summarize now, kidneys are important for electrolyte homeostasis. Neonates have physiologic renal failure, impaired tubular function, and impaired urinary concentrating ability. Hence, electrolyte disturbances are common in a neonate, especially when they are sick and low birth weight babies. Both acute and chronic dyselectrolytemias are associated with morbidity and mortality. A simple clinical approach, starting with detailed history and basic lab parameters, can assist in arriving to a diagnosis. Most common causes of hyperkalemia are vomiting, followed by diuretics and then tubulopathy. And redistribution of potassium from ICF to ECF, kidney failure, and aldosterone deficiency or resistance are the common causes of hyperkalemia. I would like to stop over here and take any questions or any suggestions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mehul. And as usual, you made the topic so simple. Such a difficult topic is now looks very simple. There are a lot of questions, obviously. There are some questions like urinary electrolytes utility during babies on IV fluids. So will it remain the same whether babies on feeds and IV fluids?
Yes, it will change, especially if the child is getting potassium in the IV fluids. To some extent, it will change, but the parameters are not going to change drastically as compared to when the child is taking diuretics. So the oral and parenteral IV fluids are not going to change the parameters significantly that it will deviate us from the differential diagnosis. But certainly if the child has received diuretics, it can modify the urinary electrolytes. And if the child is taking caffeine, which is a very common occurrence in low birth weight neonates or preterm neonates, caffeine, as we know, is a potent diuretic and it causes natriuresis. So I think drugs can definitely contribute, but not so much, I would say, the IV fluids or the oral fluids.
You did stress about constipation in Bartter. Why is there constipation in Bartter?
I think there are three main reasons for constipation. One is the volume depletion itself. So because of volume depletion, the supply to the myocytes in the intestines is going to be limited. That's one. Hypokalemia, which is a common occurrence with Bartter syndrome, is a contributor for constipation and hypomagnesemia as well. So it's a volume depletion, hypokalemia, and hypomagnesemia.
You did say that 50% of Bartter have Mehul or have Bartter, but I was thinking the magnesemia is a differentiating feature between Bartter and Gittleman.
Not really, Srinivas. Theoretically, it has been mentioned that yes, if we have hypomagnesemia, we need to first look at Gittleman syndrome, because magnesium is actively reabsorbed in the distal convoluted tubule, which is the area of involvement in Gittleman syndrome, the sodium chloride co-transporter effect. Why do we see hypomagnesemia in Bartter syndrome? Because if we go back, calcium and magnesium, the two major divalent anions, are reabsorbed passively across the paracellular membrane, across the paracellular channel in the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. So when there is a defect in either the sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter or the renal outer medullary potassium channels, the reabsorption of this divalent cations is also impaired. And hence the magnesium and calcium reabsorption, which takes place about 40 to 50% at this level, is also not going to happen. And hence we end up having hypercalciuria as well as hypomagnesemia. So it's not a completely differentiating feature. That's true.
Okay. Now, what is the experience of non-oliguric hyperkalemia in preterm units? Non-oliguric hyperkalemia in preterm units.
Yeah. So I think certainly up to 6.5, we should not worry about. I'm assuming the renal function is normal, right? That's what you're meaning, Srinivas?
Yeah, that is what.
So I think the potassium up to 6.5, 6.6 is quite routinely noted. One, because of the physiological red blood cell breakdown which happens, and the severely impaired renal potassium secretory function. So I think up to 6.5, 6.7, we should not worry about it. As the GFR matures, the renal secretion is going to get better and the potassium gradually comes down. So we should start worrying about potassium in preterm babies only when it crosses 6.5, not below that.
You did suggest in the case scenario, the cystic fibrosis presentation. There is a question whether cystic fibrosis can present with hypokalemic, hypochloremic metabolic LSA as an isolated finding.
Yes, it can. It can present with only hypokalemic, hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis. And that's what I was mentioning, that there are different presentations of children with cystic fibrosis. What we as postgraduates were told, and we did not see actually that commonly 25, 30 years ago, is that most children with CF would have severe lung disease. But that's only one part of manifestation of cystic fibrosis. Some children may present with only failure to thrive with GI losses. Some may present with recurrent pancreatitis. And we have had few children ourselves who have presented only with dyselectrolytemia, which just gets better when treated with sodium and potassium supplementation and treating them in the environment. So yes, that possibility is there, yes.
So when do we start Brufen in Bartters? There is the question here.
Yes, I think that's a tough question. I think the opinion is divided over here, but I would say the majority would still wait until the child is at least 2 to 3 weeks of age, until the GFR has matured, until the intravascular volume depletion is replenished, using non-steroidals early on in the neonatal period has its own risk. The one risk is that if the child is dehydrated and we use non-steroidal, we are going to push the child into acute tubular necrosis in an established form of AKI. That's one major concern. And second thing is the risk of necrotizing enterocolitis is high in the first 2 weeks of life. So I think certainly we should be a little careful in using non-steroidals in the first 2 to 3 weeks of age. I per se have been using it beyond 1 month when the renal function is better. As we know, it doubles at around 2 weeks and then triples by around 6 to 8 weeks. So the risk of renal injury and the GI side effect is going to be lower beyond 3 to 4 weeks of age.
You did mention about TTKG in your presentation. And you did say that because when we read the literature in children or in adults, they say TTKG is more powerful than FINA or FICA.
Yes.
Here,
yes.
But you did say that fractional excretion is better in newborns than in children?
The main reason, again, since I was focusing only on potassium homeostasis and disorders, I didn't go into the maturation of the renal tubular function. And as we all know, that the only good thing which the neonatal kidney can do is diluting capacity. Neonatal kidneys diluting capacity is as good as ours, which is 50 milliosmoles per kilogram of water. And why is that necessary? Because the newborn's feet are basically milk, which is a hypotonic fluid. So in order to get rid of the extra water, the neonatal kidney has to have an intact diluting capacity. Whereas the concentrating ability is not developed because the medullary interstitium is not well developed. The transporters are not developed. The concentrating capacity of a newborn is only 300 milliosmoles per kilo as compared to an older child, which is up to 1200 to 1400. In order to measure TTKG, one of the parameters is the urinary osmolality. So because it is impaired or immature to begin with, it will not give us an accurate finding. We are going to have a confounding variable over here, and hence we should not be using it. It's not that we cannot use it, but there is a high chances that it may give us errors because of the impaired urinary concentrating ability, which is physiological in a newborn.
So one of the attendees says they had a very similar case like our case 3 presentation here. Very severe hyperkalemia, not responding to potassium binders, insulin drips, and even PD. His question is, what else could have been done? And very high aldosterone. I'm presuming it is pseudo-hypoaldosterone.
Yes. I think, seniors, in fact, I would like to share with the group that our first patient seniors we managed together. Yes. About 18, 19 years ago, and that child is doing fine because his cousin has had nephrotic syndrome, and based on that, I have been able to see that child, and that child is absolutely fine now, 17, 18 years of age. Wow. The bottom line in managing a patient with PHA is to give them salt, salt, salt. Remove potassium as you are doing in terms of temporary measures, and this patient would need potassium binding resins. I would not agree that the patient would need dialysis, because this is a situation where the child is dehydrated, and in dialysis you are going to make things worse. So dialysis may help us for maybe 1 or 2 days, but ultimately long term the patient has to be on potassium binders. We either give rectally if it's beyond 2 to 3 weeks of age, which is when the children would present, or we add potassium binding resins, that is the K-exalate or K-bind, to the milk. Let it settle down for about half an hour so that the K-bind will bind the potassium inside the milk, strain the milk, and then give the strained milk to the child. That way we are reducing the potassium intake, giving salt so that more salt is still nephron, and let the child slowly gain weight, because there is going to be a spontaneous maturation of the mineralocorticoid receptor by 6 months of age. And I would say a potassium of up to 6 in this patient is absolutely acceptable, because children with chronic hyperkalemia, they always do better as compared to acute hyperkalemia. So we would not worry about potassium up to 6 in this patient. We don't need to vigorously try to bring it down below 5.5, which may be almost difficult.
In your presentation, yes. In your presentation, you did not touch anything on Liddle's and hyperaldosteronism.
Yes.
As one of the differentials for hyperkalemia.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. The reason I didn't discuss seniors is because I was trying to focus only on potassium disorders in a newborn.
Okay.
The situation of Liddle's will come when we are dealing with a child who has got hypertension with hypokalemia and mild metabolic alkalosis, because Liddle syndrome is a syndrome opposite of PHA, where there is increased activity of epithelial sodium channel and there is increased sodium chloride reabsorption and potassium secretion.
True.
And that was the reason I did not discuss
it. Doesn't present at all in a neonatal period.
That's right. Yeah, the child may present by 6 months, 1 year of age, because of failure to thrive. And as we know that one of failure to thrive, and I know Most of us are now routinely checking blood pressures in a child who has come to us and who is not doing well. So, but not in the newborn period, Srinivas. Not in the newborn period.
At what age tubular function of newborn becomes similar to adults or children?
Yes. Now, there are different aspects of tubular function. If we look at the sodium bicarbonate reabsorption in the proximal tubule, it's by 1 to 2 months. The sodium chloride, sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter in the thick ascending limb of Dupont-Fenley also matures by around 2 to 3 months. So most tubular functions, I would say, matures by around 2 to 3 months of age, except for the urinary concentrating ability, which matures by 2 years of age. But most we can say safely by 2 to 3 months of age.
For measuring electrolytes, is spot sample always enough or a 24-hour sample is almost must?
It's a good question, but I think a random urine or a spot urine sample is more than adequate in most children with electrolyte disturbances. We do not need to do 24 hours. We do not need to do, as long as we are always obtaining urinary creatinine when we are obtaining urinary electrolytes as well, so as to eliminate the effect of water content of the urine. So always obtain urinary electrolytes with urinary creatinine to calculate the fractional excretion of either sodium, potassium or chloride. It should always go hand in hand.
The other thing is, you did mention about tubular dysgenesis. Did we mean ARPKD?
Yeah, that's a good question. Now, this is something which I have been learning over the last several years. This is a condition called as a proximal renal dysgenesis or proximal renal tubular dysgenesis. It's a condition where the proximal convoluted tubular cells are not properly developed. This is different from ARPKD, autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease, where it's a genetic condition involving cysts in the cortical collecting duct cells over there. Whereas PRD, proximal renal tubular dysgenesis, involves a proximal convoluted tubule, and it is because of two main reasons. One, an inherited problem because of mutations in the renin angiotensin genes, or it could be acquired because of intake of non-steroidals and because of intake of ACE inhibitors and ARBs by pregnant mother. Because we know that ACE inhibitors and ARBs, they will block the angiotensin 2, and angiotensin 2 is a potent growth factor for proximal convoluted tubular cell growth. So if we block angiotensin 2, the renal tubular dysgenesis sets in. So this is a different one, yes.
No, but we know that antenatally both the echogenic kidneys,
yes,
and renal failure. So is there any different, is there any thing to differentiate? Is there reason for differentiate or is it?
I think it's a very good question, and I'm still learning on that, Srinivas. But what we can say that both of them will have echogenic kidneys. Both of them will have oligohydramnios. The one difference would be in the size of the kidney. Usually with proximal renal tubular dysgenesis, the kidneys are normal size. They will not be small, but they'll be normal size. Whereas with ARPKD, usually the kidney sizes are enlarged. So if we have a normogram where we can compare a kidney size of a 1 month old child with ARPKD with that of a normogram, it will help us. So I think it is a kidney size which will help us. And many times it is the follow-up over a period of 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. In ARPKD, the kidney size will keep on increasing. Like at 6 months, it may be 6 centimeters and 8 centimeters.